becomes the ganav. I'll repeat. Maseches Bava Kama. We are back on Zoom. Yay. Bava Kama Intesa Mudalef. Everything nice. Zoom and lots of people here in the room. Things cannot be better. Baruch Hashem. Boy Ameima. Bava Kama Intesa Mudalef. We said before in the Mishnah that if a ganav, I'm just repeating the Mishnah outside the Mishnah. No. Before the Mishnah, I owe you one. Remember yesterday, I was a little bit unsure in this whole area, in this whole part of the Gemara, about the ganav who consecrates, who's makdish something, and that hakdosha is considered to be geneva. Why is it geneva? As Tosfos said, because when we talk about hekdesh, which is kedushas domim, lebedek habayis, not sorry for the short stop. Let's start now in the Gemara. Yeah, there's a bit of a mishap with Zoom again. Now, in the Mishnah, what did we say? The Mishnah said that the Ganev tells the Shoimer, you, Mr. Shoimer, Chinam Socher Shol, you be my Shoimer, or I'll rent it for you, or I will be Shol for you. He likes to cut corners, the Ganev. The animal is still in the house of who? The house of the original owner. Nachon? Still by the original owner. And the Ganev doesn't want to pull it himself. He says to his, not exactly even a messenger, he tells the shomer, you pull it out of the owner's house, and maybe the shomer thinks that the owner is the ganav, yeah? Let's go to this and that house. You pull the animal, become the shomer. Once the shoyel, shomer socher, chinam socher, wherever one of the four becomes shomerim, and they pull it out of where? They have to be moishachit outside the house, lead it outside the house of the original owner. Then, just like the ganav himself wants the meshicha done out of the domain of the owner, out of the screen, so too, if the shoimer, which is like the messenger of the ganav, does the same, he pulls it out of the house, that's gneva. Two for the price of one. We cut corners. That's how the Mishnah works, begadol. The same thing goes for a kohen. A kohen who instantly thinks that this guy is a nice guy, the one who has a baby, and he says, instead of giving you five coins, I'll give you the sheep. And the sheep is right over here, and you do meshicha, Mr. Kohen and the sheep. Once the Kohen was moishech, the sheep, did kinyan meshicha outside the house of the owner, the ganav becomes a ganav, and then he's chav kefal. And that's it. Okay? Whether the shomer knows or not is a good question. They discuss it in the portion of the Mishnah. Let's assume he doesn't. So therefore, he's innocent. If he does know, it's a different question. We'll keep it simple that he doesn't know, and therefore he's not liable. And the one liable is the ganif. Says the Gemara, boy ameima. Oh, now we come to a very, very, this piece of Gemara is an extremely a fundamental piece all over Shas, the inyonim of shoimrim. Everybody here knows that once a shoimer, this week's parsha, last week's parsha, everybody knows a shoimer, give a name of a shoyel. Shoimer chinam, let's say, not shoyel. Shoimer chinam. Shoimer chinam, once he became a shoimer chinam, and then he was negligent, pshia, he has to pay. I'll ask you a question. Where does it become a shoimer? What point does it become a shoimer? When it comes to kinyonim, when I actually acquire a shoimer, when does it become... No, of course, chinam or socher is anyway. No. No matter what point in history, what point in the chronology, what has to be done so it becomes a shoimer? The conditions are a separate story. The chinam socher depends what they agreed upon, baal peh. But at what point is a shoimer called a shoimer? You can say, oh, it's your responsibility, you got to pay. Or another question, let's say I want to lend you something, and at some point, and I said, I want to lend you the thing, and at some point I say, no, I don't want to lend it to you. You're not nice to me this morning. You're like a Zoom today. I don't like you. And therefore, I'm not going to lend you my drill. Can I do that? Can I just go back on my promise to you that I'm going to lend you the drill at any given moment? No. There is a point in which the she'ela, even though it's for free, there was a point of no return. What I'm trying to tell you is, just like the kinyonim, we all know that if we just verbally talk about a kinyon, it's not a kinyon. I tell you, you know, I'll give you and I'll sell you and I'll buy and I'll sell and schwindel and not schwindel, of course, willing dealing on one schwindel, yeah. And this and all talk, it's all talk. As long as there's no kinyon of, give me never McKinyon. That's a nice name. Agba, as long as no kinyan hagba, I don't owe you anything. Everything can be revoked, right? In other words, there's a point called kinyan, and that's a point of no return. What happens by shoimrim? What do we call a point of no return? And there are two nafkaminas. At the point of no return means that from that point onwards, the shoimer is chayev. He has to, he's called a shoimer, and responsibility is on him. And also, another nafkamina, that me, as a mash'il or maskir, rent you my car, rent my phone out to you, I want to rent you out my computer. People do that, yeah? At what point do we say, that's it, the she'ela, schira, or shmira are a done deal, and from that point, you are liable, and I cannot return either. At what point do we say that? Says the Gemara. Boya Mema, says the Mema, tiknu meshicha b'shoimrim oiloi. A Mema has a question. When it comes to shoimrim, did Chachomim also were metaken? Did Chachomim establish the concept of shmira? The first wide line, by the way, for those who like the wide lines, yeah? Were they metaken shmira in shoimrim, yes or no? When a person, yeah? Do we say that a shoimer, just like a koine, just like a client, just like a buyer, the point of meshicha, meshicha dan, boom, point of no return, it's set in stone. Do we say the same thing in shoimrim or not? By the way, I combine here three different rishonim. When I told you there are two nafkaminas, that they cannot return, yeah, the shmashal maskir, and also that the shoil cannot, and the shoimer is ready chayiv to pay if anything happens. Is the meshicha the crucial point? Did Chazal say that too by shoimrim and not only by koinim, not only by when I actually buy it off you? Amar Rav Yema, shoil is one of the four. Yes, yes. Shoil, shomer sochol, shomer chinam, and stoicher. Maybe he could, but not the mashiel. That's usually the case of mashiel. The mashiel can't go back. I made a promise that I'm going to lend you my drill for 2 days right before Sukkot. Then I realized I need it. Once you did meshicha, I could have come in la locha. I'm not a poisik in choshemish, but that's going to be a good question. Let's say the guy did meshicha, and there's a very clear verbal agreement that I will borrow your, maybe even written, I will borrow your drill for 2 days. Yud Gimel and Yud Beis and Yud Gimel Tishrei, everyone needs the drills then. And what? And now you want to return? Now you want to go back on your words, the mashil? He can't? Maybe. Is that so? Toshma, let's see. Omar Vyema, let's listen to the Mishnah. Let's read the Mishnah. Toshma, come and listen. Nesona lebcholes bnoi. The ganef gave the sheep or the whatever for the b'choyres of his son. Oh, because the koyan is supposed to get 5 sloim. Instead of 5 sloim, he's giving someone else's animal. Oy lebal choyvoy. Or he wants to pay his debt with someone else's money. Ponzi. L'shemer chinam. These are the four friends of ours, the shomrim. Let's focus on the shomrim now, not on the other ones, because they are the stars of the show today. They were pulling and pulling the yoitze, but the animal died while the animal was still in the domain of the bailim. The meshicha didn't make it to the outside the domain of the bailim. Potu, then the, who's potu? Everybody. The ganev is potu because gneva wasn't really done. But you see that the mashma, wait a second, let me continue myself without the mishnah inside. But if the meshicha was finished, let's say the meshicha was finished or was outside the domain, we see that the meshicha done by the shoimer and the shoimer vis-a-vis the ganev, the meshicha is really meshicha. And that meshicha affects the ganev himself. So you see, meshicha is something very valid and crucial in the process of Shmira. My love, Shomer. Who is the one who pulled it out? The Shomer. So you see, if the Shomer pulls or doesn't pull, makes a difference. He has a pull. The Shmamino, you hear from here, Tiknu Meshicha b'Shomrim. So you see that Meshicha, yes, was established by Shomrim. So here we see that Meshicha b'Shomrim is a very crucial point for all the different Nafkaminas. By the way, the Rishonim argue, let's say Toistvas in Bava Metzia Daf Tzadites Amud Aleph, I checked it. He says the only nafkamina of Shoimrim is, like I said, you can't go back on your word if you're the lender or the rent, not renter, the one who rents out. Yeah. But says Toistvas, if Mitzad Shoimer, when does he become Shoimer to become liable? He says, once he says it verbally, without doing Meshicha. Once the Shoimer Chinam says, I will be your Shoimer, is Chayev, without Meshicha. But that's another opinion. Yeah, is it very again not to the yes, thing? Yeah. Well, no, he was before. Sorry. One second. You're after him. Yeah.
The Meshicha
does, says the Gemara. The Gemara now wants to reject the attempt to prove. Omalei, the line starts with the word lei. Ganev. Maybe really, we talk here in the Mishnah that it's the ganev, which means, says Rashi, look at Rashi, Bachikoma, Nosan Bala Bais, the Bechoros Benoi. Really, the Bala Bais is the one who gave it to a Kohen, the real owner, the good guy. He gave it to a Kohen or to a Shoimer, and the ganev stole it from the Shoimer. Maybe that's what our Mishnah means, against everything we said. Maybe the Mishnah is telling me that a ganev is the same chiyuv, whether he stole it, the same set of chiyuvim and the same system of chiyuv applies to the ganev, whether he stole it from the house of the owner, or if he stole it from the house of a shoimer who is working on behalf of the owner. A note to your wife. No. Okay. The Gemara thinks maybe there's a chiddush that the ganav stole from the shomer's house and he's also chayiv. Says the Gemara, Mapitom, Matani L'Reisha. No, the Reisha already told me, the Reisha at the beginning of the Mishnah already told me that the ganav himself is the one who pulled. So again, you're telling me that the ganav pulled. What's a chiddush? And says the Gemara, no. Tane ganav shugonu mibeis abayrim. In the Reisha, we speak about the ganav himself who stole straight from the owner. That's a classical case. But the Seifa talks about a ganav who steals from the house of the shoimer, who's working on behalf of the bailin. Yeah, he stole Shimon's drill while it was in the house of Judah, but it's still stealing from Shimon's drill, and it's the same system exactly, same rule, that you have to pull it out of the shomer's rishus. So you think it's a bigger chiddush? I hear very nice. Baruch says maybe stealing from the shomer's house, which is not really the Bailim's house, is a bigger chiddush because it's not really the owner's house. It's the Shomer's house. And we use the same, we apply the same rules that you have to pull it out of the domain, even though it's not really the owner's domain. It's the Shomer's domain. Nice. Oh, okay. The Gemara, and it doesn't, I hear what you're saying. Omale Ravashi. Ravashi says no. Loi tidche. Don't reject him. Don't reject the proof from our Mishnah. No. I don't accept the story of a ganev who stole from the house of the shomer, because unfortunately it's not a chiddush. The Gemara says Mali ganev shegonav mibeis shomer, Mali ganev shegonav mibeis bailim. What's the difference? Who cares whether he stole from the house of the shomer or he stole from the house of the owner himself? What's the difference? Because at the end of the day, everybody knows, it's the Gemara in many places, that a Shomer's house, once the Shomer is for the Bailim, it's like the Bailim's house, at least around the area of the drill. What? It's an extension, that's a nice word. When my drill is in my upstairs neighbor's house, yeah? So then the drill is killing my domain, halachically. Of course, he or she cannot do anything with the drill without my permission. And of course, anybody who steals it from their house is stealing from me. And therefore, it's not such a chiddush. Therefore, must be El Alav Shoimer. Must be the Mishnah should be read in a big chiddush, like we said before. We're talking here that the Shoimer himself was working on behalf of the Ganev. The Ganev got a Shoimer, his Shoimer, and he says, please look after my sheep. And by the way, it doesn't have to be a sheep or an ox. Like Ellen told us today, Ellen asked the question. We're not necessarily talking about our Bava Chamisha anymore. We're talking here about any object. It could be a drill, could be a phone. Yeah, let's say I want to steal a very nice phone from someone, and I say to the shomer, you pull it for me. You'll be my shomer. He doesn't know that I'm a ganev, but he's yes, mischayev to me. Between me and him, there is a obligation. And yet, v'shmamino, tiknum shicha b'shomer v'shmamino, and that's the maskono. We see that a shomer, you see that the point of no return, the point that's very important for us, where the shomer becomes the shomer of the ganev, and that makes the ganev the ganev. We cut corners from the shomer straight to the ganev, straight to the owner. The whole thing is one big story. We see that important point when the shomer became a shomer is by meshicha. So we see meshicha was established by shomerim and not only by buyer and seller. Itmanami. If you have questions, you'll have to wait one more minute. Itmanami. We have another statement, another Amoraic statement to assert what we just said, to endorse what we said. Amar Blozo, Kederch Shetiknu Meshicha Belekuchois. Music to our ears, right? just like meshicha was established for lekuchos. What do you mean tiknu? It's not money. According to Rabbi Yochanan, money, kesef, geld, cash could work for metaltelin, to buy movable goods from one to the other. But chachomim were metaken, the money should not work. Because if you pay cash and the goods are still in the house of the seller can say, I'm sorry, it got burnt in the attic. What can I do? And I won't compensate you. It's not Marks and Spencer over here. Yeah, and therefore what? Made the takana, meshicha works. The object has to be physically in the hands of the buyer. So just like by a buyer, they made the meshicha and other kinyonim, physical kinyonim, ach tiknu meshicha b'shomrim, bu, mazel tov. Meshicha works for shomrim. I checked yesterday in a sefer called Shulchan Aruch. Yeah, did you hear about this sefer by Rabbi Joseph Caro? And he says, that's aloha. Aloha is tiknu meshicha b'shomrim. And therefore, a shomer is only liable both ways. The bailim and the shomer are both considered to be in the story set in stone once meshicha is done. Not verbal and not shmerbal. Tani nami achi, one more proof from a b'raisa. B'raisa is more than a moira. Kedech she'tiknu meshicha b'lekuchos, kach tiknu meshicha b'shomrin. Just like the established meshicha and lekuchos, and meshicha works for a lokeach, and nothing happens before that, so too, meshicha b'shomrin. A shomer becomes a shomer only once he does meshicha. Okay, I'd like to continue one more line, but if you have questions, it's a more or less okay time now. Yes, question? How do you know? Ellen is saying that just like meshicha works for everybody, meaning buyers, customers, so too it should work for shomrim. That's a chiddush. A shomer is not a buyer. He's not a buyer. He's not buying it for me. A shomer guards it for me. It remains absolutely mine. Who says meshicha would work for shomrim just like for customers? I absolutely need the Gemara in Daf and Tesa Modalek Bava Kama to tell me that. I would have said when it passes clearly from me to you, you're under my ownership, then it's your ownership. Clear cut, I need meshicha from one domain to the other. But when it's my drill, which you're looking after for free, no money, no nothing, how do you know meshicha is acquired? You're working for me for money and not for money voluntarily. How do you know meshicha would work? I wouldn't have known that. I would have thought it's a way to be koine, a way to acquire. All four people are not acquiring anything. They're either working for me or they're benefiting from me, but they're not buying it from me. It stays mine. So maybe meshicha wouldn't work. That's absolutely a very strong avamina. Comes the Gemara and tells me what you're saying. What you're saying is true, but I need the Gemara to tell me that. It's not automatically understood. Absolutely not. And by the way, according to the Ramah, I think it's the Ramah, he says no. He says whatever. I don't want to get into that, but it's not simple at all. Okay, that's then you continue. Yeah. Scheiter. Continues the Braise. Ukeshem, another comparison we're about to draw between Kinyan and Shmira, who are not the same. Ukeshem Shakarka Niknes Bekesef Bishtaru Bechazoko. There are three different ways, three alternative ways. When one wants to buy a piece of land, he can either buy it with money, not even the entire amount. Even after you gave, let's say, the first payment, the first some kind of even small payment, now and it's verbally agreed on, and then money exchanged hands, and the land is there. The land is not sitting in anyone's attic. So by land, the kesef requires the land. Shtar, we've seen extensively in Bava Basra, shtar's work, a written document. Ubechazoko, what's chazoko of a karka? The person behaves in the karka as if he's the owner. He closes it, opens it, makes furrows. Remember, he picks the fruit maybe. Yeah, he paints the walls in a way that cannot be changed. Yeah, he carves something. He behaves like a balim. Those three ways are the ways the Mishnah in Perek Rishon Kiddushin. These are the three alternative ways to buy a piece of land, as opposed to a kinyonim, where it's supposed to be metaltelin. These three don't work. So to kach schirus niknes bekesef b'shtar b'chazoko. So to renting also works these three ways. When you renting is borrow here, I agree with you more. Renting is like a mini kinyan, according to some rishonim. When you rent, it's like a smaller scale kinyan, like an incomplete kinyan. So schirus also is the copycat, you know, it's like a little sister of the kinyan, real kinyan, and it's the same ways to acquire the land. You also rent the, I gave it out already, land. You rent the thing, the ketzer shtar b'chazoko. Frag the Gemara, what are you renting over here? Schirus demai, What kind of rent? If you want to intest amud beis, if you want to acquire schirut, not acquire, if you want to rent metaltelim, you want to rent someone's computer, you want to rent someone's phone, which is common today. So schirut metalteli, is that what you're talking about? And you're telling me kesef shtar chazoka metalteli bnei shtar aninu? No way. Metaltelim can never be acquired with a shtar. In other words, metaltelim cannot be acquired with a shtar, let alone be rented with a shtar. Yeah, because it doesn't work. Metaltelim are nikneh with physical things. Metaltelim are physical. They're little things over here that are passable from hand to hand. And they're nikneh behagbo, meshicha, mesira. These things are not nikneh with a shtar. Shtar is just words in the air. We're talking over here about schirus of a land, regular rent. Like today, people rent apartments and sometimes they rent flats. And when they rent the apartment or the flat, how do they actually become the real renter? At what point do we not return and you are called the renter and not the landlord, and that's it set in stone? At the moment of either kesef, shtar, today shtar is very common. You sign a contract, I don't know if that's halachic shtar, but that's what's accepted today, or you gave money, you gave the first payment, then that's it. Or chazoka, you behaved in the land with the consent of the landlord. You already lived there, you did something, you closed, you opened, you did something substantial, which he allows to do, then you call the renter. Now we're going to go into the very interesting Gemara to define the difference between a neganev and a gazlan. So we all know that a ganev pays kefal. We said that in the Mishnah, and a gazlan doesn't. A gazlan pays the original amount called keren, and doesn't pay kefal, and of course it doesn't pay above a chamisha. Let's redefine the difference between ganev and a gazlan. Ra'u shehitmin b'choshin. People saw him that he was hiding in the forest, and in the forest is where the animals graze. Not a very thick forest, like a grazing area. Yeah, that's where all the animals are, but it's a bit of a hidden place. It's not in town. He's not the one walking around town with a gun and he pulls out a gun and he mugs everybody. He stands there in the choresh, in the forest, and that's where he steals the animals. The tovach u'mochar, and he did tvicha u'mechira over there in the forest. He took an animal, where it used to be, and he attacked it, and he slaughtered it, or mochar, or he sold it right there and then. Meshalem teshlum abo v'chamisha. So he pays 4 and 5. What? What are you talking about? Amai, why? Allah Moshach, he didn't pull it anywhere, right? Didn't Rabbi Tachta tell you that first you have to be Moshach, do Kinyan Gneva, and then Tlichu Mechira? But if the person takes the animal, doesn't move it, and says, hey, be a good girl, just stay right there, and he pulls a knife and shechts it, there was no Meshicha. So Isaac Chai 4 and 5. You're not Chai, if you shecht someone else's animal, you're Mazik. Mazik pays 1, just an Ezek. That's like throwing a rock at the window of the neighbor, yeah? But you didn't pull it to become a ganav and then did the tficho mechira. That's how it's supposed to work. Amav chizda, don't worry. Yes, he did. Shehekisha b'makel. He did not pull it with a string or with a leash or whatever you want to call it, with a collar. He just, hekish b'makel, he hit it a little bit with a stick and made it move. Made it move a little bit, made it move the whole length, made it move daladames, machlokes tanoi, amaroin. In other words, he made it move, which we've seen already before in more than one place. Meshicha doesn't have to be pulling like you pull a dog in a park alone, yeah? Like you pull a dog, it has to be causing it to move one way or another. And you remember, some say even if you say, and it's moving because of your noise, some say that's also considered to be yakorol of a hibo. He called it and it came, already it's called Meshicha. You made it move and it's clearly, so he did move it. He created the kinyan Meshicha. That area in the forest is now temporarily belonging to the cow owner or the sheep owner. You moved it out of there with a stick, and then you shechted it. You're a ganav, and you shechted. That's 4 and 5. Amri, frag the Gemara, wait a second. The kevan de ra'u, gazlan hu. Wait a second. If people saw him, didn't we say ra'u shehitmin? People saw him hiding. He wasn't such a great hider. He does not play hide and seek. They saw him hiding there, but they saw him. Isn't he a gazlan? Right? A gazlan is a person who does it, what? In your face. A gazlan is brazen. A gazlan is one who's not scared of anybody. A gazlan goes around town stealing. So if the gazel was seen by people, and that place, the choresh, the forest, is a rather public place, is he a gazlan? So what does he pay 4 and 5? Pay 1. And says the Gemara, no. Kevan de kamitamli minayu ganevu. Because what's mitamli? Because he's hiding from them, he's a ganev. He's not a very good hider. He was seen by people. But lamaisa, he attempts, he tries to hide. He tries to hide from people. So even though he was seen, but lamaisa, he's trying to hide. If he's trying to hide, he's a ganev. One second, Baruch. Rashi asks a very brilliant question. He asks the question, every ganev was seen by someone and every gazlan, because two people saw him. Two people saw him and took him to Beis Din, right? So says Rashi, a ganev is the person who's scared of everybody. And even if he saw the two Edim, he thinks those two Edim, they won't snitch on me. Why? Because I'm stealing Reuven's animal. These are Binyamin and Yosef. I hope they'll keep their mouth shut, but he's trying to be very quiet. He's a ganev. Masha'enken, yeah, and that's the guy over here also is considered a ganev. Why? Because this person is trying to hide, he's called a ganev. But a person who openly, says Rashi, chol shemira lakol, yeah, in the Havamin of the Gemara, yeah, if somebody goes to a place where many, many animals of many people graze together, he doesn't know which animal is stealing. Hey, excuse me, you're crazy? Maybe the one who steals, Reuben and Shimon, maybe they're the owners. You're not scared of them? You're not scared of, you don't, there are two people who see you, strangers, and you're stealing an animal from a public place where lots of people keep lots of animals. You're not scared of that? Because you're saying in your heart, I don't care. Even if these Reuben and Shimon are the owners of the animal, I don't care about them. That means you're a gazlan. And so the Gemara, no, he's not a gazlan because he tries to hide. Because he tries to hide, he does his best to hide. Not a very good hide-and-seek player, okay? He should have had better education when he was a child. So, but Lamaisa, you see that he's trying to hide the best, yeah? Then he's a ganev, and then he has to pay 4 and 5. Gazlan is one who brazenly does it without caring. However, I'm sorry, Boruch, we really... Ve'ela, Frag de Gemara, Gazlan hechidami. So what's a gazlan? In other words, if a ganev is somebody that was seen by people, Lamaisa, how brazen does a gazlan have to be? How would you define gazlan? How much in your face does a gazlan have to be? How audacious does he have to be? How open, overt does he have to be called a gazlan? We're going to see now machloikis about it, and with sources from the Bible, from the Tanakh. Amar biabo, Kigon Bnaya ben Yoyoda. Bnaya ben Yoyoda was one of the heroes of King David, one of the giborim of David HaMelech. And what does it say about Bnaya ben Yoyoda? He wasn't scared. Shenemar, it says, he stole, he snatched, in nice modern English, he mamash took the chanit, the spear, from the hands of the Egyptian, and killed him. War is war. He stole it from the Egyptian, like that, straight in his face, and stuck it in his heart, and killed him. That's Gazlan. Yeah, he doesn't care at all. And the Mephoshim say over there that he has scary face. I don't know if Bnayo had scary face with the Egyptian. I think the Egyptian. The Egyptian was very scary looking. I think it was Egyptian. I'm not sure if it was. Yeah. And Bnayo ben Yoda was such a hero, so brazen, so mighty. He didn't care. So courageous. That's a gazlan. Rabbi Yochanan Omar. One second. Rabbi Yochanan says, Kigon Bali Shchem. Another example, arguing on the first one. Bali Shchem. What's the story of Bali Shchem? Shenema, it says, the people are from Shchem. Not the Arabs, they're very brazen, the Arabs in Shechem and Machshemam, what they do, yeah. Shenema, they're Gazlonim Roitzchim. That talks about a shoifet called Avimelech. Avimelech was a shoifet who misbehaved and he killed his own family. He had a brother, Yoisom, Yotam, and there was a whole row between them. Avimelech was misbehaving. Hashem punished him that his allies, the people of Shechem, turned against him. That's in a way sometimes, you turned against your family, and you became, you made an alliance with people of Shechem. The Shechem people will work against you. And what did the people of Shechem do eventually when they turned against Avimelech? What's the ma'arav? Ambush. Oh. Yeah, they ambushed. The people of Shechem would ambush Al Rosh Yehorim. They would stand on the mountaintops and would look at people like people today, sometimes the Indians, I think, right, in America. The Indians, no. All the books about the first whites and Indians in America, right? The Indians would jump from it. So then, Whoever would go by, the Anshei Shechem would come out of their ambush and attack and charge, assault, and take whatever that person would have, highwaymen. So these are Gazlonim. These are called Gazlonim. So Rabbi Abba says, Bnei Ben Yoyoda, who at war stole the spear. And Rabbi Yochanan says, the people were in ambush and attacked the people, but then they openly attacked whoever came their way. Frag the Gemara, what's really the argument? Rabbi Abba, my time alo omar mehai. Why didn't Rabbi Abba want to say the reason of the source of the people of Shechem would be hiding in the mountain and then jump on people, charge the people? Omar lecha, that's not a gazlan. That's not my gazlan. Kevin de mitamri itmuri, because they hide. Most of the time, they're hiding. They only come when they charge, but they're hiding most of the time. They don't openly come and steal and kill everybody. They hide, and then they jump on people. Lo gazlani ninu. That's not a gazlan. That's a gel alocha. We're not talking here history or, you know, biblical stories. That we're talking here, la alocha. According to him, according to Rabbi Abou, a gazlan who hides and only charges and then goes back to his den is not a gazlan. He's a ganev. He would have to pay 4 and 5. Rabbi Yochanan. Why does Rabbi Yochanan define those highwaymen who would ambush and then surprise the people? Why does he say that they're called gazlonim and not ganovim? Why does he see them as brazen? He says, very, very logical answer. You know why they hide? Not because they're scared of anybody. Why does the person lie in ambush and not openly? Very good. They want a surprise. They want to have the surprise effect. That's why, of course, it would stand in the way. They want to surprise you, so you won't be ready to their attack. Says the Gemara, "De lo nichzinu inshi." So people don't see them. Ni'arku minayu, ni'arku, run away. They want people to run away, or maybe fight back. Depends how courageous you are. But the Maisa, of course, those people who hide in ambush and then they come in charge, they're called gazlonim. It's only war tactics that they're hiding, but really they're called gazlonim. So they won't have to pay. They will not have to pay above a chamisha. So again, so somebody who's hiding, a real scaredy cat, a real chicken, of course, is a ganav. Somebody who comes to you in the middle of town, or somebody like Bneyahu ben Yoyada, who comes to you and openly steals, and he has absolutely no pachad, like a soldier at war, open, face to face, of course, is a gazlan, no question. The question is, a gazlan who lies in ambush, remember? Gazlan lies in ambush and in and out of his den, that's not so clear. On one hand, you can say he's very brazen, he just wants to surprise people, or you can say no. He prefers to be in hiding most of the day because he also wants to avoid the police. So mimela, that's a machlokes already. Another machlokes, if you remember, within Rabbi Yochanan, in the Ba Daf Nun Zayin, we said, yes, it was about listim mezuyan. Remember, the person who is a listim is a person who comes with a knife, but he hides his face. Also, so that's also Shiloh, is he called a ganav or a gazlan? Anlan came to the, like that. I didn't come with my wallet. There's nothing to steal. We have. No, I think Baruch was first. Baruch. And to continue, says the Gemara, Shalu Talmidav Rabbi Yochanan ben Zakkai. These are Tanoim talking, of course. The Rabbi Yochanan ben Zakkai was asked by his disciples. Why was the Torah stricter with the ganav more than the gazlan? Omer lohen. Well, finally we see it inside the Gemara. How you believe me? Ze ishva kvoid eved l'kvoid koinoi. The gazlan compares the slave to the master. The gazlan, what does he do? He's not scared of people, not scared of Hashem, not scared of anybody. The ganav. Yeah, the ganav is worse. He's not comparing the slave to the master. He's more scared of people than he's scared of Hashem. Kivyochol, as if also ein shalmata kilu ein royo, oizen shalmata kilu ein shamas. He made, I don't know what's called ein shalmata, not shalmala, I don't know. Maybe it means, ein shalmata means Hashem's eye, which is down by us. He doesn't realize Hashem's eyes. He believes in God, of course. The ganav believes in God. He steals all the dollars, which says in God we trust. But Lamaisa, he doesn't realize Hashem's eye is down here and Hashem's ear is down here. He made Hashem as if Hashem is deaf and dumb, Chas Shalom, Shenema, as it says in the Pasuk, Hoy Hamamikim Mehashem, those who kilu go amok, deep, hiding from Hashem, listo eitza, or lastir eitza, you can darshan it to like hide, the seser, to do their things secretly. But the mechshach maaseim, their dealings, their doings are done quietly in the dark, perceived. And it says, what about those people? Vayamu lo yirekov, lo yavin elokei Yaakov. They say, Hashem doesn't understand. We do it secretly, so the police doesn't catch us, and the rabbis don't catch us, and the mechotonim, the shiduchim, they don't care about Hashem. Uksiv, yomu ozav Hashem esaretz, ven Hashem roya. They say, Hashem left the land, and it doesn't see really what this person believes in. Maybe believes in Hashem, but he does not believe in Hashgacha Pratis. He said Hashem left the land. Hashem, there is such philosophy. Hashem created the world, and then he wants us to do whatever we want. He's not Mashgiach. He's not supervising anymore. There's no divine providence. So that's really is very, very bad Hashgacha. And in a way, it's worse than the Gazlan. Nobody says the Gazlan is a tzaddik, and you know, not to offer a shidduch to me, right? But Lamaisa, the Gazlan, is the Marsha is a very nice explanation, which we'll see later on. Marsha says very, very nice explanation. You know what? I'll say the Marsha now. Outside. Says the Marsha like this. The Gane, the Gazlan, just like, what does the Gazlan think when he steals openly? Yeah, he does realize, Alan, that at some point the police will catch him. But he says, I'm making a calculation. It's better for me to have the fancy phone now. I want the car. I want to steal now. Eventually, I'll be caught. It's worth it. It's worth the risk. He's playing, you know, risk factors. I want to have the joy now. Maybe later the police will catch me. In jail, I'll deal with it. It will be okay. I'll manage. So the same logic maybe uses for Hashem. He believes in Gan Eden and Gehenim. He says, that phone, I need to have it. Food, I need to buy food. I'm hungry. I want to steal food from wherever, from Osher Ed. And what? Later on, Hashem will punish me. I'll manage Yom Kippur. Don't worry. But he does believe in some system. The same way he believes or does not believe in the legal system, he's trying to manage. And he says, okay, we'll be fine. It's worth for me to have the instant gratification. He says the same thing about Hashem. It's not fear in Hashem. Maybe he's lacking understanding of what's getting him. But Sheinke and the Ganev is so smart. The Ganev is not willing to take risks. The Ganev does everything possible, the whole plot, the whole hoax, to run away, not to even get the police's attention to begin with. So the Ganev is very, very smart to avoid the police. So he's not saying it's worth me for me to steal the phone and Achi Arbe, I'll go to jail. No, I'll steal the phone and won't go to jail. That's terrible. Aren't you scared of Ganev? Aren't you scared of HaKadosh Baruch Hu? It's much worse. Because you are very well planned, and you did not put the Kadosh Baruch Hu in that very plan. Oy vavoy, much worse. Continues the Gemara. Amar b'meir, we have to finish the Mishnah. It's very easy, and then you can ask no questions. Amar b'meir, moshlu moshol mishum Rabban Gamliel. He gave a moshol, a fable, an allegory. Beshem Rabban Gamliel. B'mar dover doime. What is the story of Ganev and Gazlan? What is it similar to? Leshnei bnei Odom. There are two people. Two people of the same town, same community, goes to Mishta. Let's say each one married off his son. Yeah, chasana, Baruch Hashem, lots of chasanas now, Corona, no, Mazel Tov. Yeah, one does a chasana in Kinor David, the other one does chasana in David Kinor. Yeah, so now each one does a chasana, makes a chasana. Echad zimen es bnei ha'ir, v'loi zimen es bnei ha'melech. One of them invited everyone in town except for the children of the king. Ooh. Is anti, how do you call it in England? The queen. Anti-monarchy. That's just people in England? Yeah? He's anti-monarchy. But Azimah is b'nei ha-melech. Yeah? He dafka did invite the monarchy. The echad, the other one, is tamisnab. Lo azimah is b'nei ha-ir. But Azimah is b'nei ha-melech. The other one didn't invite anybody. He's either very poor or very snobbish. A closed event. Corona. I only had 40 people at my daughter's wedding. I had no choice. Yeah, even that was too much. The beginning of Corona. Yeah. So then what? He didn't invite anybody. Which one will be punished more severely by the king or the queen? Which one is worse in the eyes of the monarchy? Of course. Right? The one who invited everybody and deliberately did not invite the children of the queen or the king. But much worse. Yeah. He's anti-dafka them. He blacklists them. It's much worse. He'll be punished by the melech, as opposed to the one who stand in invite everybody, including the melech. That's very bad. He didn't invite the monarchy, but he didn't invite anybody else either. That's even more forgivable. And the nimshal is very clear. Here, you're not scared of anybody. Okay, you're not scared of Hashem, of police, of anybody. The guy is crazy. The guy is very instant gratification just too crazy by him. So he doesn't think of anything. He's just not calculated. But the one who's calculated and not scared of Hashem, much worse, is dafka excluding Hashem, yet out of the picture. And that's much worse, and that's the ganev. Omer Abimeir, one more, and that's another famous line, and it's Rashi in last week's parsha. Omer Abimeir, and now we explain about the 4 and 5, the difference why by Yaseh you pay 4, and by Yashor you pay 5. Bo e kama godol koch shel melocho. Look how important work is in the eyes of halacha to cause a person to stop a person from working is a very bad thing. Shor shebit lo mimelachtoi. When you stole someone's ox, it's like stealing what? His tractor, his combine, in today's terms, his truck, his working car. Hamisha, you pay 5 because you caused him not to work during those days that you stole it. Se shelo bit lo mimelachtoi arba. The se, he did not cause him not to work. Of course, it's terrible. The se is a se. Everything is terrible. You still pay 4. But you pay 1 less because se, which is the sheep or the goat, is not a working animal. You don't plow the field with them. And therefore, you only pay 4. Omar ben Yochanan ben Zakkai has a different take on the matter. He says something else. Bo ekam agodol kovod abriyos. Look how Hashem cares about the dignity of people, people's dignity. Shal sholach beraglov chamisha. The shor, while the ganev stole it, he didn't have such bushes. He walked with the shor. I guess it's a very normal thing to do. Like today, people walk with dogs, which I don't like, but you know, that's what's done. So he walks with the shor, and the shor was walking along on his feet. So then the ganev himself did not put himself to shame while he was stealing. He was walking with the shor. That's like more elegant to walk with an animal behind you, towing along. Se shirkiv al ksefoy. Say, it's not normal to schlep the say, it's too slow, too little. What do you do with the say? You put it on your shoulder. That looks more shameful. That looks more funny. You walk down the street with a say on your shoulder, like, what's that? Arbo. Unbelievable. Even though it's all the Ganev's fault, and it's all the blah, blah, blah. But if the Ganev himself already was misbazeh, caused himself a shame by the actual theft, yeah? So therefore, we deduct it from the 5 he should have paid. Kilo one, he already paid by being shame, by being ashamed, being embarrassed. So now he only has to pay 4. It's his fault. You see that Kosh Baruch Hu is not like the Goyim, the Torah law is not like the Goy Shalom. We're not trying to be vindictive and punish and call him a gun over this. We make him pay, make him 4 times over. That's not so easy, yeah? The Maisa, but he doesn't pay that would already put himself to embarrassment, doesn't have to pay. I have more to add, but questions now or no? You good? Fine. So the Maisa, the Rishonim, and the Choronim say that this rule doesn't always apply because remember Toin Tanis Ganav? Remember him? By the way, tomorrow we're starting a whole new, amazing, interesting Mishnah about the Takonos of Ezra and Takonos of Yeshua. Both Ezra and Yeshua made 10 Takonos, 10 rules how to maintain. How to live nicely in our holy land. Yeah. So all kinds of residential and otherwise takonis, and that will be the next few days. Very interesting tomorrow. We're done with all the theft for now. And we're going to finish Merubah Mirtz Hashem in about a week or so. And I'm also going to Chutzlartz, hopefully, Blinei there in 2 weeks. No, not again. Again, I'm trying, and hopefully again, they'll allow me on the plane. I hope so, Be'ezras Hashem. Now, what I wanted to say was as follows. You should realize the difference between Ganev and Gazlan also affects the verbal Ganev. Remember, let's say, a little test over here. Let's say if a person gave his animal to a Shoimer, and then the Shoimer swore and said, I'm so sorry, it was stolen. And I swear to you, Besefer HaTorah, it was stolen. And then it was found out that, no, it's in his backyard. Oops. How much does he have to pay? That Toyen Tanis Ganev, who verbally told me a tall tale about a thief, how much does he pay? Careful. And if he says, no, a guy came with big guns blazing, I had to give it. He says, Toyen Tanis Gazlan, how much does he give? 1, no extra. Here, the Rishonim asked, the logic doesn't work anymore, right? Because the Ganav is the one who is a scaredy cat, not scared of people, scared of people, not of Hashem. The Gazlan is not scared of anybody, but the liar is the same kind of liar. So why is it that the ganav, the toitan is ganav, pays kefil, and the toitan is gazlan only one? What? No, so how can you compare the toitan is ganav to toitan is gazlan? They're both lying the same. No! So why does one pay kefil and one pay one? But the thief is not the same chiddush here. When he was dieting, at the beginning of the sugya, I saw the Rambam. The Rambam says that the Toitan is Ganav is instead of the Ganav. Yeah, he's like the Ganav. The Ganav you built in your mind, that's you. And the Gazlan you built in your mind, in imagination, is you. So even though you, Mr. Liar, you're not more or less scared, but you get the same din. Just like a real Ganav would have to pay double. When you created the Ganav here in the story, we give that din of your imaginary Ganav to you. And Gazlan also goes to you. So it's true that locally, by the way, the Shloh says something, the Yamshu Shlomo says something similar to what I'm saying. Even though you are not more or less scared of people or Hashem, but Lamaisa, you put yourself into the Maslul, into the box called Ganav, and here to the box called Gazlan. A real Ganav would have paid kefil. You created a Ganav here, an imaginary Ganav. Now it's you. A little bit like Edim Zomimim. Similar. Think of Edim Zomimim. The person who lies X or lies Y, it's all the same lie. They just lied. But if you lie that someone, stole 500, you have to pay 500. Yes, if you lie that he stole 2,000, you have to pay 2,000. Why? It's the same. Lying is lying. LMI, no. You have to give, you have to be punished the same way that you were created. You created here a reality of punishment. They will go on you. That's why you died to the store over here. I'm glad that people like the Chidushim. Yoras Kama. Thank you very much. And Atzlochu Abba, tomorrow will be very, very exciting in Eretz Hashem. Everyone will be here. About the Tekoros of Ezra, what you're allowed to breed in Eretz Israel, what you're allowed to do, all kinds of interesting. And tomorrow is Rosh Chodesh. Tomorrow we start 9:25 in the morrow in Eretz Hashem. Okay? Thank you. Shkoyach and Zoom was working. Wow, can't be better.